Good. Call us to order, please.
Since the Federalists asked me first, I had to say no.
Good morning. Can we get started, please? Thanks. So I'm Nick Rosenkranz. I'm a professor at Georgetown Law School, and I'm on the board of directors of the Federalist Society. I'm delighted to be here moderating this panel, and I want to applaud you all for being here at 9 a.m. on a Saturday morning. This panel was conceived of by our own Eugene Volokh, and he gave us the idea for this panel and described what he thought it would be, should be like, and we took it under advisement and we said, you know, Eugene, this seems like a terrific idea, we're delighted, and you know, how do you think you will moderate the panel? And he said, Saturday morning, 9 a.m., no, I'll be watching that on video. So I'm here moderating this panel, but it was a great idea for a panel, and we have a very esteemed group here. So the thought, Eugene's thought, was to talk about multiculturalism. This seems to be the word of the decade, although it seems to mean quite different things to different people. And Eugene points out that it's actually an idea that has quite a long tradition here in America. So his thought was, could we put some of these modern debates about multiculturalism into historical context and try to think a bit about you know, the ways in which the American project and the American structure of government is, you know, designed to foster a certain sort of multiculturalism, but also to constrain a certain sort of multiculturalism. A lot of things about American structure are, you know, deliberately, foreseeably multicultural. Religious liberty, I guess, paradigmatically, but free speech, private property, these are all things that, in a way, foster a certain kind of multiculturalism. On the other hand, though, we you know, we have a, there's a sort of a strong countervailing instinct that there should be constraints on multiculturalism, and in this day and age, probably paradigmatically, anti-discrimination norms. So when does multiculturalism bump up against our anti-discrimination instincts and norms? How do we resolve those sorts of dilemmas? But as you see, these questions have really taken on quite a modern cast recently. We've seen controversies on campus about cultural appropriation, which I think would have actually mystified the founders. But maybe, you know, when we're going to put some of those modern controversies into historical context, we have a terrific group of panelists to discuss these issues. They're each going to talk for about 12 minutes, and then we're going to have a bit of a discussion among ourselves up here and then open it up to audience questions. So each of these people has a hugely impressive bio. I am not going to go over them in detail. I want to urge you to have a look at them on the web if you like. Very briefly, we have John Eastman here, who is a professor of law and former dean of Chapman University. We have Marianne Case, professor at University of Chicago Law School. We have Rick Garnett, a professor at Notre Dame Law School, and Heather McDonald of the Manhattan Institute. Again, these folks are hugely impressive. Please look to the web for their full bios. So with that, I'll get us started, and we're going to start with John Eastman giving us a bit of a historical perspective on this question.
Thanks, Nick, and thanks to the Federalist Society, and I guess thanks to Eugene. It was his idea, conceived, and I'm gonna criticize his choice of words in the title. I think that's always a good way to begin, particularly when the guy that chose the words isn't here. Multiculturalism is probably a word that would have surprised the founders. It was a completely foreign term to them. But if we take it descriptively, perhaps it can come in. The opening line of the Declaration of Independence talks about one people. And it's patently obvious from the very beginning that that notion, that language, isn't true in the traditional sense, right from the outset. The Puritans in New England, the Germans in Philadelphia, the Dutch in New York, Catholics in Maryland, Jews in Newport, Rhode Island, the Anglican landed aristocracy in Virginia, under their traditional terms, that would hardly qualify as one people. And so I guess we were multicultural in some sense, pluralism from the very beginning. And they could have easily embraced that term, that modern term, and did. The slogan E Pluribus Unum, that E Pluribus part out of many, certainly encompasses that idea. And yet they use this phrase, one people. And trying to understand that dichotomy, I think, is where I take issue with the word multiculturalism to define from 1776 on, because it's the ism part that they would not have accepted, I think. That turns the word from a descriptive adjective into a noun, from a description of what exists or a prediction of what we might become. Here as an American people, to an end purpose, not describing that we come from different backgrounds and different heritages, but in fact that difference is the goal. And I think that's completely antithetical to their understanding of the thing. They never would have embraced that, and indeed they did not embrace it. The other half of that slogan, E Pluribus Unum, the unum part, out of the many comes one. And so we have to look, how did they take these disparate cultures, these disparate race and ethnic and religious backgrounds, and make them one? What is it that did that? What's the understanding that lets them say at the beginning of the Declaration of Independence, one people? What is it that makes America unique in that regard, even exceptional? And it was the American idea. You see it in Washington's letter to the Hebrew congregation. You see it in Abraham Lincoln, and I'm going to call him a founder here because he kind of taps back into this understanding. But most directly, wonderfully, in his what often is called the Electric Cord speech, the Chicago 4th of July speech, kind of comes on July 10th, but close enough. For those of you that don't know or don't remember the speech or haven't looked at it recently, I commend it to your attention, but I'll give a little bit of it here. Now, he gets together 4th of July. I mean, this is like the biggest thing we celebrate as Americans every year. And Lincoln comes in almost a week late. Now, it happens that we meet together once every year, sometime about the 4th of July, for some reason or another. I mean, what a wonderful understatement of the significance of this holiday. These 4th of July gatherings, he says, I suppose have their uses. If you'll indulge me, I'll state what I suppose to be a couple of them, some of them. And then he traces it back, obviously, to 1776, and he says we've had a wonderful amount of prosperity and trying to figure out what it is that we had. He said we find a race of men living in that day whom we claim as our fathers and grandfathers, right? And so there's the direct connection, the genetic connection to the folks of the day. They were iron men. They fought for a principle they were contending for, and what we got is a lot of prosperity. In every way, we're better men of that age, the race and the country for which we live in these celebrations. But after we've done all this and celebrated that founding, he says we have not yet reached the whole. There's something else connected with it. It's not just one people. We are, besides these men, descended from blood by blood from our ancestors, among us perhaps half of our people who are not descendants at all of these men. There are men who have come from Europe, German, English, Irish, French, Scandinavian, men who have come from, whose ancestors have come hither and settled here, finding themselves our equals in all things. If they look back through our history to trace their connection to those days by blood, they find they have none. They cannot carry themselves back to that glorious epoch and make themselves feel that they are part of us. But when they look through that old Declaration of Independence, they find that those old men say, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. And then they feel that that moral sentiment taught in that day evidences their relation to those men. That is the father of all moral principle in them. And they have a right to claim it as though they were blood of the blood and flesh of the flesh of the men who wrote that declaration. And so they are. That is the electric cord in the Declaration that links the hearts of patriotic and liberty-loving men. that will link these men as long as the love of freedom exists in the minds of men throughout the world. So the uniqueness of American multiculturalism, if you will, to try and take that, is that it takes disparate ideas, disparate cultures, different races of people, different religions, and unifies them around a core idea, the American idea. The multicultural American idea, if you will, or rather the universal proposition that is the American idea. Now, it's also that understanding of that that creates some other challenges with the modern idea of multiculturalism, or rather that there are aspects of modern multiculturalism that would have been equally foreign to the founders. First of all, this idea, this universal idea, this idea of American plurality, e pluribus unum, is forged in a claim of universal truth, not merely a parochial claim. Modern multiculturalism is instead just the opposite, grounded in parochial notions that ought not to be overcome and in fact ought to be preserved and celebrated. It's that universal truth, though, that made it possible for the Americans to be both multicultural but also one. E pluribus and unum. Now, those universal truths also constrain, and I think part of what we're going to try and talk about today is how they constrain. Theirs was not a nihilistic vision about multiculturalism, that every culture, every claim was equal, all cultures are equal, or whatever. That they would have thought that a little bit bizarre. And we find evidence of this in various places. So I want to just focus on a couple of places. We have in the Constitution, in Article 6, the requirement that everybody take an oath to be officers of the United States or the states. But we have an exception to the oath requirement. Now, modernly, that exception, but that shall be bound by oath or affirmation, is treated as allowing all sorts of folks who don't believe in God or whatever to be able to swear out this oath. But that was not what the founders understood that exception to be. The oath or affirmation, the affirmation exception, was designed specifically to accommodate those whose religious scruples prevented them from taking an oath. The Quakers, the Moravians, the Mennonites were the folks. It did not apply, oddly, from our vantage point, to atheists, for example. In fact, we have a long history of atheists being excluded from testifying in court because they did not recognize a higher authority that would kind of be the source of this eternal punishment, that the reason for the oath was there. That itself kind of demonstrates an accommodation with pluralism, but also a restraint or a limit on how far those accommodations are going to reach. John Locke, who drafted the Carolina Constitutions, put this in. Lastly, those are not all to be tolerated to deny the being of God. Promises, covenants, and oaths, which are the bonds of human society, can have no hold upon an atheist. And he goes on. So we see this attempt to allow for pluralism to reach certain accommodations, but a limitation on how far that can go. The embrace of pluralism or multiculturalism, as you will, couldn't go so far as to challenge the basic norms and mores that were necessary to keep the civil society together. It's not just atheists. Joseph Story reminds us that some of these charges were leveled against Catholics, the papists, as they called it. In his commentaries, he says, as to papists, what has been said of the Protestant dissenters would hold equally strong for a general toleration of them, provided their separation was founded only upon difference of opinion in religion, and their principles did not also extend to a subversion of the civil government. Now, right there, the line, he's trying to draw the line, and his particular application of it with respect to the, quote, papists, as long as they are willing to renounce the civil supremacy of the Pope, they could enjoy their religious sacraments, their purgatory, even their transubstantiation, he says, but while they acknowledge a foreign power superior to the sovereignty of the kingdom, they cannot complain if the laws of the kingdom will not treat them upon the footing of good subjects. So we find in those couple of passages, the oath clause and how it extends, both a requirement That we accommodate the different cultures, the pluralism that made America so great, but also confine it to the limits of it. And where do we look for those limits? We look to see the things that would help us advance the universal principles that give us that uniqueness at the very beginning. And any multicultural claim that would destroy those principles, therefore, would violate those limits and need not be countenanced in a civil society. Now, the story and many of his colleagues were wrong about the impact of the Catholic Church, but the principle they tried to articulate there, the line they tried to draw, seems to me one that we can try and scope out a little bit as we try and grapple with an ever-increasing claim of pluralism, of multiculturalism, including from cultures that may be antithetical to the universal principles that the Declaration sets out. And we find today, modernly, a very difficult time in challenging those claims. The founders would have not had any difficulty whatsoever. I think that they would have recognized that you do not get the claim to advance your culture if it's going to destroy the culture that is allowing you to make those claims. And I'll close with this. I'm reminded of the One Nation Under God litigation by Michael Newdow some years ago. And I remember in particular one line in his brief, and he said, even if the First Amendment doesn't let me win this case, I ought to be able to win it because this violates higher truths. And I asked him, I said, Michael, where do you get the notion of higher truths? well, they're right there in the Declaration. I said, yeah, they come to us from the Creator, the very thing you would deny. And so the self-contradictoriness of his claim, I think, gives us something to explore self-contradictory claims of various multicultural claims today. That if there's a multicultural claim that will destroy the possibility of pluralism in support of that universal truth, then it ought not to be, and need not be, and ought not to be countenanced by a society that is designed around the universal truths of the Declaration of Independence. All right, thanks very much.
Thanks very much, John. Now we have Marianne Case.
So I am in somewhat surprising agreement with much of what John said. First, let me say how the topic was pitched to me by Leotis, because that will explain where I'm coming from. It was originally pitched to me as, we're going to talk about, quote, traditionalist multiculturalism. How it has been supported throughout American history through institutions such as religious liberty, parental rights, freedom of speech, private property, federalism, open immigration policy, and the like. And like John, I'm going to focus on one word in the title, and that word is limits. And I'm going to talk descriptively rather than normatively about some examples from history which I think show the limits of a multicultural claim over history. Starting with the religious liberty multiculturalism claim, I think John was absolutely right that with limited exceptions like New York and Pennsylvania, the religious groups had their own separate spaces, and in Puritan New England in particular drove out those who didn't conform. Whether that's a multicultural world or not really depends on your definition. I also have repeatedly had occasion to say that Americans for the first centuries of their life on this continent were extremely lucky with respect to their religious differences, because they were by and large differences about what to believe and how to worship in the narrow sense, and not about how to live in society. And the moment radical differences about how to live in society came into the picture, viz. Mormon polygamy, they were slapped down hard. They were not tolerated. They were not allowed to flourish even in their own separate space of Deseret or later Utah. And that problem, I think, has carried through with religious differences about how to live in society down to the current RFRA debates and the current broader religious accommodation debates. Another example with respect to religious liberty is the multicultural move of the Catholics at a time when the state-sponsored schools or the government-sponsored schools were teaching the King James Bible, and there was the so-called Bible Wars, where people were fighting about, among Protestants, which version of the Bible to teach. What the Catholics said is not, we want out, but we want in. We want our own state-sponsored schools in which we can teach the Douay version, and nuns and priests and habits can inculcate these values with government subsidies to our kids. They lost, and they then, like the Jews, started their own parochial schools. I think this is instructive along a number of fronts. First of all, people who don't know much about ordinary American state law or even the Constitution claim, of course, in the U.S., no one would ever do what the Germans have done, what the French have done, which is to control the wearing of hijab in classrooms. Nonsense. There is a Supreme Court case on point applying a statute that was originally targeted at nuns wearing habits to say that a hijabi teacher could in fact be controlled. It's a case that was dismissed for want of a substantial federal question, but nevertheless that has some precedential value. I also have long said that there is a very interesting parallel between the reaction of Protestants to their ownership of the public schools and their ownership of marriage. So if you look at both instances, what you have is, so what I was trying to do is understand from the inside the claim made largely by evangelical Protestants that, quote, their marriages are threatened by same-sex marriage, a claim that's very often ridiculed on the proposition that, you know, if the lesbians down the street are getting married, why, what does that affect us? Well, I think the problem is that, as with the public schools, so with marriage, Protestants have abdicated to the state the formation and dissolution of marriage, and they don't have, unlike Catholics and Jews, their own juridical system to adjudicate who's married, so they are dependent on state marriage. I think one wonderful example of this is that it was not until 1999 that the Southern Baptists made part of their doctrine officially that it was a wife's duty graciously to submit to her husband's servant leadership. Not a new idea for the Baptists in 1999, but until the Ruth Bader Ginsburg Revolution, they could count on the state to enforce that for them. So they the Protestant, you know, if you look at numbers on same-sex marriage, Catholics, whose hierarchy is strongly opposed, have always been in the lead, 20 points ahead of the rest of the country 10 years ago, on same-sex marriage, because they don't have an investment in it. They can say and understand that marriage as the state defines it and marriage in their religious tradition is not the same. And so they're less dependent. And again, the Protestants maybe will do with marriage what they have done with schooling, which is when they lose control of an institution that never should have been theirs in the first place, when with the elimination of the Bible, of prayer, and the continued controversy about evolution, they now have a reason to start their own private schools. Moving on, other examples I think are examples of limited multiculturalism in the U.S. Are slavery and Jim Crow. These are efforts to have, and particularly Jim Crow, as it is positively defended by folks. This is about two different communities who do better separately, that have their own norms. You know, there are people now in the African-American community who might say, there were some good things about separation, and there certainly were people in the white enforcers of Jim Crow who would have described this as a form of multiculturalism. And it didn't work. I've said about same-sex marriage what Lincoln said about slavery. You cannot have a nation survive half slave and half free. And we can leave open for debate which half of same-sex marriage is slavery. If you're Lynn Wardle, you think it's same-sex marriage. If you're me, if you think it's its absence. But I think it is perfectly true, and this gets to the question of whether we are unum e pluribus, that it is not possible with those kinds of radical differences about how to live in society to live half slave and half free. Other examples of the old multiculturalism that I think reveal its limits are, I think Sutherland was right in New Stateice and not Brandeis, that constitutional limits are uniform across the country. And these kinds of variations, when they bump up against constitutional limits, can't long survive. I had a project for the longest time that I called molecular constitutionalism, looking at ways in which constitutional rights might vary from place to place. Think about, for example, search and seizure. When a judge in New York said in a multicultural sort of way, it is reasonable for a young black man to run from the police, and therefore the fact that he is fleeing should not be seen as evidence of wrongdoing, there was such a national outcry that he had to withdraw his opinion. But there is, in theory, the possibility for this kind of variation among federal constitutional rights, depending on how life, liberty, and property are defined at the state level. My colleague Will Bode is now working on something on the Fourth Amendment concerning this. The only, as far as I can tell, constitutional right that has been allowed, even in theory, to vary this way is the right to sell rather than use obscene material. So the Miller test is a multicultural test. But it compares, it's not a federal test because it says the people of Maine or Mississippi versus the people of New York Las Vegas, I think. Anyway, large cities. But that hasn't really had that much traction, and especially in the internet age, it's hard to see where the localized communities are, and the American way has always been to look at outliers in their communities. Which brings me back to another modern religious example, the town of Greece. What is the multicultural vision in the town of Greece? Is it that the town of Greece is a multicultural unit of Christians who are allowed to have Christian prayers? Or is it, by contrast, that the multicultural outliers within the town of Greece, the rare Druids and pagans and Jews, need to be represented? So again, with every multicultural question, the question becomes whether we have diversity between or diversity within particular communities, and in a place of universal rights, there are always going to be limits. Another example of limits on multiculturalism, minority districts, and the long line of cases beginning with Shaw v. Reno that I think my former colleague Pam Carlin correctly described as Justice O'Connor describing as segregated among the most integrated districts in the country, because there was a similar notion, as with Protestant dominance, so with white dominance, that anything that called into question white dominance might be seen as segregation and segregatable. I'll end with a trial balloon of something that I have been calling, and we'll be talking more about at the next Federalist Society event in UVA, what I think of as the new feudalism. So instead of the new multiculturalism, I think we have something that I'm calling the new feudalism, in which our rights are depending more and more rather than less and less on our hierarchical attachments to our state, to our employer, to our family, to our church. The ACA, I think, is a great example of this. And in scare quotes, my favorite case in the line of ACA challenges is the one in which a parent of an adult but under 26 child said, "My children are to me what Notre Dame's students are to it, what Hobby Lobby's employees are to Hobby Lobby. And therefore, I get to say, based on my religious beliefs, whether they are entitled as adults to contraceptives." But there is no way out. I mean, we are now in the position where we can choose our hierarchical master, right? We can choose a state of residence. We can choose an employer. We can choose a church. But once we've made those choices, a lot of other things are constrained. So either the new feudalism or the new domestic relations is what we've got, which is not liberty and justice for all on equal terms, nor is it, I think, the old or the new multiculturalism.
Next up is Rick Garnett.
I hadn't thought of a cool title for my talk, but I think Marianne just gave it to me. I'm going to call it A New Feudalism, A Defense. So I want to, you know, echo everybody in saying thank you to the FedSoc and to all the staff, especially my friend Anthony Jurdiff for putting together this thing year after year. And thanks also, of course, to Eugene for including me. You know, I realized a few weeks ago that I was so pleased to be invited to this event, and I so quickly said yes when Eugene asked me that I forgot to really think about whether I was qualified or prepared to shed any light on the topic, which is a big one. But I've been assured that the topic is so huge that I could talk about pretty much anything and still stay well within my assignment. So that's comforting. But I spent a few hours a couple weeks ago on the Google machine, and I confirmed, because one always wants to confirm one's intuitions by looking at Google. And so I confirmed my intuition that this idea of multiculturalism is associated in a lot of different ways with another idea or another term. And that's, as we've heard, E Pluribus Unum, the motto that was suggested by the committee that Congress appointed on July 4th, 1776 to design a, quote, seal for the United States of America. Now, in some of the cases and sites that Google uncovered for me, it was interesting. There were various multicultural, or self-described multicultural projects and works and enterprises that were presented as illustrations or instantiations precisely of this idea of E Pluribus Unum. So there was, for example, a Los Angeles County Office of Education project, kind of an institute for public school teachers, and it was called the E Pluribus Unum Project, colon, a multicultural institute for teachers, pulling those two things together. The purpose of the program was to help teachers and their students create and maintain healthy intercultural communities and competencies. But in a lot of other instances, especially in a lot of commentary, one or another aspect of multiculturalism, or one story or another about some kind of funny display of multiculturalism, was contrasted by the commentators with what they saw as this ideal that our great seal is supposed to reflect, that is, out of many, one. Now, it seems very generally that the debate about multiculturalism then has long involved, among other things, an argument about whether this motto, this little Latin phrase, is first descriptively accurate, and we've heard some questioning about how descriptively accurate it really is, and second, whether that aspiration is attractive, whether it's attractive culturally or morally or politically or what have you. So one way to put that, I guess, is to say, when we're talking about multiculturalism, one of the things it seems to me we're asking is whether that motto, E Pluribus Unum, really does express something true, either about the American experience, or I should say, about the American experience and or about American ideals. So I just want to do two things pretty quickly, because one of the things about going third is other people do things better before you did it, and so you can do less. I want to first identify a couple different things that I think we're talking about when we're talking about multiculturalism. And second, and then to kind of put those aside, and then to self-indulgently draw on my own academic work in the First Amendment area, and just suggest quickly another way of thinking about this many versus one dichotomy. So when I think about my own encounters with multiculturalism over the years, it seems to me there have been at least three different versions or flavors. So first, there's the kind of civics class, Schoolhouse Rock, Benetton ad, Epcot Center multiculturalism, which is basically a kind of description and also a celebration of what's proposed to be the fact that in America, in American history and tradition, whole lots of different people have come from whole lots of different places, spoken different languages, practiced different religions, or at least different strands of Protestantism, cooked and eaten different foods, and so on. This is the melting pot, or maybe sometimes the salad, or maybe the food court vision of multiculturalism. But it's a claim, a descriptive claim, about what our experience has been and about what America is. And so in this sense of multiculturalism, what's being said is that American culture simply is a product of, and an ongoing mixing and swirling around of, a great variety of practices that are borrowed or migrated from other cultures. In other words, what our one is in fact many. The next flavor that I've encountered, I think, has a bit more of an edge to it, I guess. It's not just the cheerful celebration of the fact that, hey, look, in America we have towns called Des Moines, Milwaukee, and Corpus Christi. In America we love hamburgers, pizza, and burritos. Instead, it's identity politics. This was the sense of multiculturalism that seemed to be on display when I was in college and law school in the late 80s and early 90s. It's the kind of multiculturalism that I think folks like Arthur Schlesinger were worried about in his Disuniting of America, for example. And it's the kind of multiculturalism that I think folks like Tom Wolfe in The Bonfire of the Vanities displayed really colorfully. So in this sense, multiculturalism is not just a sentiment expressed in the children's song, Jesus loves the little children, or It's a Small World After All. This sense of multiculturalism is about representation and validation. It's about affirmative action plans and about ethnic studies academic departments. It's about selecting particular justices to fill particular seats or about hiring particular faculty to mentor particular students. It's about who's authentic as a representative of a group and who's not. Again, it's about identity and power. That's the second kind. The third kind or sense of multiculturalism is really a claim about truth and the capacity of human beings to know things and to know the truth. This is the multiculturalism, I think, that runs through some of the debates that some of you might be familiar with about, you know, the extent to which human rights norms should be imposed upon, or at least human rights should be demanded of other countries. Can we really impose our values on other cultures, is the way the question is sometimes put. This is the sense of multiculturalism that I see at work in a lot of debates about university curricula or about, you know, literary canons. Can we really say that there are any great books that truly speak to something called the human experience or the human condition? Is there such a thing? Can we really try to equip our students to seek after the true, the good, and the beautiful if there is no such the? Is it all just relative? Are texts simply occasions for expressive performance and so on? I'm sure there are other ways the term has been used and other meanings that many of you can think of, but those are the three that kind of jump out at me, and I want to put them aside. What I want to do is talk about another way of thinking about many and one that might be a little less familiar at first, but I think it'll turn out to be very familiar to those of us, to all of us as American lawyers. So I'm thinking here not so much about the fact that we have different cuisines and languages and ethnic groups or religious traditions. I'm thinking about the relationships and the distinctions and the rivalries and the competitions among different authorities, different jurisdictions, different powers. Hence my gratitude to Marianne for the new feudalism. I'm thinking about pluralism, not in the sense that words sometimes use of just sort of saying, oh yeah, people think different things about different things, but in this political theory sense, that we really can say that there exist within one culture or within one border or within one community, multiple authorities, multiple powers. And scholars that some of you know, like Jacob Levy and Victor Muniz Fraticelli, have published some recent, I think, really excellent books that are trying to refamiliarize us with this ancient idea of pluralism. Right? We can associate it with certain British thinkers like Figgis and Maitland, but we can obviously push it a long way back even then. And I realize this seems pretty abstract, especially on a Saturday morning in a hotel conference room. But we could bring it more up to our own experience by thinking about, you know, the American Constitution and American public law. A lot of us are very used to teaching cases that tee up the question, how do we relate different claims of authority to each other, right? What about the claims of authority that are circulating in a case like Christian Legal Society versus Martinez, where you have the asserted authority of a university over its own policies, the asserted authority of a student group over its own membership requirements, and of course the asserted authority of the state, right? Whether it's California itself or the university. We could think about the American Constitution, sort of its structural features that I imagine a lot of us teach to our students in the first couple weeks of every semester, right? And of course it's huge here in New York thanks to the Hamilton play. We all teach, I think, as Madison famously explained in The Federalist, that the Constitution was designed in a particular way, and that for particular purposes, and that particular way was to divide and structure authority in different ways. It wasn't an unum, right? We divided power vertically and horizontally, and we did it for a purpose. We thought, I think the debate about whether we were right in so thinking is still going on, but we thought that division and multiplication of power would help to promote individual liberty. Now, if American constitutionalism relies on this separation and limitation of different political authorities, I think it's also true in the American experience. It's part of what John Courtney Murray called the American proposition, that the flourishing and freedom of individuals depends on there being authority and associations that are outside of and meaningfully independent of the central political authority. This is what the great historian Harold Berman was getting at when he said, perhaps the most distinctive characteristic of our legal tradition is the coexistence and competition within the same community of diverse jurisdictions, diverse legal systems, and diverse authorities. It is this plurality of jurisdictions that makes the supremacy of law both necessary and possible. And so just, you know, quickly referencing the field in which I tend to work, the religious freedom field, it seems to me that it's a key religious freedom claim, and one that I think the Supreme Court seemed to endorse in the Hosanna-Tabor case, that pluralism is in fact part of the American constitutional tradition. The claim there refuses to limit the domain of law to the law of the state, quoting Berman, and it refuses to regard non-state authority as existing only by concession from the political authority. Now, going back 70 years or so, there was a Supreme Court case called Kedroff versus St. Nicholas Cathedral. I've written some about this. I know some of the others and some of you others have too. It's a fascinating case about, you know, which group of Russian Orthodox had title to a beautiful church here in New York. And after the case came down, the great legal scholar Mark DeWolf Howe wrote a comment in the Harvard Law Review, and he said, you know, what's interesting about this little case that might seem like just a land use dispute, an ejectment action, is that it actually deals with and takes side on what he called one of the classic problems of political theory. That is, and here I'm quoting, the pluralistic thesis that government must recognize that it is not the sole possessor of sovereignty, that private groups within the community are entitled to lead their own free lives and exercise within the area of their competence an authority so effective as to justify labeling it a sovereign authority. We can think and talk about that later if you want, because I've been given the dreaded 3x5 card, but just to kind of try to bring this to a little bit of a head, first, it seems to me that we can talk about the one, the unum, the political community that's created by and sort of continually reconstituted by our Constitution. We can talk about that and about the many, the pluribus, at the same time. I think we can say with John Eastman and many others, obviously, that we are united by certain shared truths and commitments, while at the same time saying that authority and authorities do exist outside the state, and that the state's power to interfere with these other authorities is limited both morally and constitutionally. I think we can say, as the framers said about our Constitution structure, we can say more generally that this idea of pluralism, this division and distinction among authorities, protects individual freedom and liberty and need not be seen as undermining the unity that is needed for a political community to thrive. So maybe the new feudalism isn't so scary after all. And then finally, like John, actually, I had wanted to end with just a thought about this one nation under God idea. It seems to me that, and I'm ripping off this idea from Tom Berg, whom some of you know, that the way one nation under God expresses this pluralistic idea is hidden, but I think also profound. The pledge purports to and aspires to unite us, right, one nation, but the under God statement, it could be seen as kind of a political / religious claim about our relations with the Soviets or what have you, but Tom suggests, and I think he's right, that what that line really does is it reminds us that the nation is not the only authority. It relativizes the claims to authority of the state, and thereby, it seems to me, leaves space for us to say, again, that there are these authorities outside the state, and that's perfectly compatible and consistent with our aspirations to a limited but still meaningful political unity. Thanks.
Next up, we have Heather McDonald.
Thank you so much. This is an extraordinary honor to be at the Federalist Society on this challenging topic, which I'm actually going to add to some of the pushback against it. I think that, in fact, to talk about the roots of contemporary multiculturalism and traditional multiculturalism is somewhat of a bait and switch and a semantic trick. I don't think it gets us very far. The current proponents of multiculturalism, strong multiculturalism, would not recognize in some of the structures that Eugene proposed for this panel of traditional civil society and federalism anything related to what their agenda is. Today's multiculturalism, I think Rick was excessively polite towards it, let's be honest, is really a narcissistic infatuation with gonads and melanin, and a lack of relativism towards ethical values, has a very strong sense of what public norms should be and private norms. And it's anti-Western and, in fact, anti-white. But I don't think even that the original founders of our constitutional structure and our key leaders since then were motivated by even a weak version of multiculturalism. Again, I think it's a word that is imported into the past that I think is really anachronistic. Some of the features that Eugene talked about, private property, voluntary associations, I don't think that was seen primarily as a way of preserving different cultures, but rather as essential components of self-government, a way of building up the moral capital of personal responsibility and self-reliance that was necessary for the republic. The ideal of local power was not a cultural issue. It was not about preserving multiple cultures, but grew out of an early theory of republics as best preserved by keeping power as local as possible. Obviously, the Federalists and the Madison sort of trumped that ideal by saying, yes, but it can also work with a large enough republic that you have checks and balances. Nevertheless, I don't think that what was involved here was anything remotely like multiculturalism. Nor was there in the early founding, I don't think, any affirmative preference for what today is known as diversity. The background assumption through much of American history was assimilation into a dominant Anglo-Saxon culture. The founders would have been astounded by the degree of diversion from what they assumed would be culturally a largely homogeneous society. They were adamant that foreign cultures must adopt. Hamilton warned that the safety of the republic depended on, quote, uniformity of principles and habits and the preservation of the national character, end quote. Washington sent a letter to Vice President Adams in 1794 advising against any encouragement of immigration except for certain, quote, useful mechanics, end quote, and warned against the mass settlement of immigrants. Madison called for excluding immigrants who would not incorporate into America, and Theodore Roosevelt inveighed famously against hyphenated Americans. He would have been astounded by the vision of Americans waving Mexican flags at soccer contests. As for the traditional sort of conservative federalism concept of preserving local and state prerogatives and a privileging of federalism concerns as a way of casting the multiculturalism question, I actually don't believe there's any sort of neutral principle for arriving at the best outcome for whether we should preserve local control and prerogatives versus federal national control. As has been brought up already at this panel, I think the Civil War, slavery, the perpetuation of Jim Crow is a real challenge to a priori principle that local control is always preferable. I know there's arguments that, well, there could have, if there was more exit possibilities from the southern states, that would have taken care of our problems, but I'm just not sure that's the case. And I think that Marianne was gave a generous view of Jim Crow as about preserving separate cultures side by side. To me, the challenge there is really are we going to tolerate states who are trying to evade the mandates of the Civil Rights Amendments? There's also some constitutional paradoxes, I think, involved in a federalism argument for local cultures, the preservation of local cultures, sometimes doing so, again, requires federal power. Some of the constitutional decisions arguing for local control down to the family level or preserving cultures themselves required very expansive readings of constitutional principles. Pierce v. Society of Sisters in 1925 ruled that a state couldn't forbid parochial education, but because the First Amendment had not yet been applied to the states, they arrived at that reading through a substantive due process analysis of the 14th Amendment. Likewise, Meyer v. Nebraska in 1923, which ruled that a state can't outlaw the teaching of German in school, was also a substantive due process case. Substantive due process has generated some arguable problems. Lawrence Tribe has celebrated these two cases as, quote, the sturdiest pillars of the substantive due process temple. That is a temple that has brought us Roe versus Wade, Planned Parenthood versus Casey, and Lawrence v. Texas. So there's some incongruities there, I think, in some of the constitutional warring principles. I'm going to close by getting very concrete in this discussion of multiculturalism and what Eugene proposed as a positive precedent for current multiculturalism in what he termed open immigration principles. And I'm going to address our current de facto open borders policy and whether what our current immigration situation is with a hugely dominant flow of immigrants, not distributed across different countries and culture, but dominant from Mexico and Central America, low-skilled, what sort of challenges this poses for the future of the nation. I'm going to argue that it's putting both the rule of law at risk and our economic and educational future. Demographics at this point is destiny, and it's also legal destiny. We see legal principles being bent to accommodate our current demographic reality. The Obama travesties of executive actions are one example of that, where he is asserting astoundingly unbound executive power in order to try and normalize and legalize this situation of large-scale illegal immigration. You have had the states refusing to comply with a federal program known as Secure Communities, which was sort of a no-brainer. It merely asked local jail authorities to notify the federal immigration authorities, ICE, when an illegal alien criminal was booked into a local jail, in order to allow ICE the prerogative of issuing a detainer on that illegal alien criminal before the local incarceration authority released him back to the community. Well, 300 jurisdictions refused to comply with these detainers. California passed a law saying that its local incarceration authorities may not comply with the federal immigration requests. What did the Obama administration do? Chastely looked the other way at this thumbing of authority, of federal authority over immigration, and eventually simply eviscerated the Secure Communities program. The Obama position on this was a complete turnaround from its earlier position on preemption and federal supremacy over immigration when it came to Arizona, which passed SB 1070 that merely authorized its local law enforcement authorities to cooperate with the federal government and ask questions if they have reasonable suspicion that somebody's in the country illegally. The Obama administration took Arizona to federal court, claiming a violation of supremacy clause, but was willing to allow 300 jurisdictions to affirmatively refuse to comply with detainers. So constitutionally, we've got some problems here. I would say economically and educationally as well. California is the future demographically and politically in this country. Half of all births are now Hispanic in California. The Hispanic and the Anglo population are now at parity. Educationally, this has been a big problem. In the 50s and 60s, California led the nation in educational achievement. Now its peers educationally are Mississippi, Alabama, and Louisiana. Over a third of eighth graders in California lack even rudimentary math skills, and nearly a third are equally deficient in reading. The education gap between Anglos and Hispanics has not budged since 1990. California's, we speak of multiculturalism, and some are arguing that our current mono flow of low-skilled immigrants are assimilating wonderfully. I take issue with that. California is the epicenter of a phenomenon known as long-term English learners. These are people who have been in the country, the third generation, and they're still classified as non-native speakers because their cognitive and linguistic skills are so low. We are seeing the birth of an underclass culture among the unassimilated Hispanic population. We have a 53% out-of-wedlock birth rate, twice that what blacks' out-of-wedlock birth rate was in 1965, when Moynihan warned that a 23% out-of-wedlock birth rate put at risk the very possibility of equality and civil rights progress. The incarceration rate among Mexican Americans jumps eightfold between the first and second generation. Welfare use among Hispanic immigrant populations is massively higher than among the native population. Half of all immigrant households use some form of means-tested federal welfare entitlements. 73% of Central American households use federal welfare. Hispanics are the largest users of government welfare. They're also the biggest supporters of Obamacare. Some are assimilating, there's no question. Some are wonderful additions to their communities. They're entrepreneurial. But by and large, we have lost the assimilationist ethic, and the uniformity of a low-skilled flow is a problem. I would argue for returning to the vision of George Washington, saying, let us select immigrants for their skills and their education capacity. That is the best chance we have today in a highly technically sophisticated society for realizing the vision of a multicultural society that is one that is advantageous to all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you also. Some very provocative things have been said at this panel. I want to start by inviting our panelists to take a couple of minutes each to respond to things that others have said or sum up or tie your remarks to some of the other comments you've heard. So, John, did anything that anyone else said provoke some thoughts?
Yeah, a lot of things. I want to push back just a little bit about something that Heather said, because most of what she said I agree with, but this idea, the Hamilton idea that we wanted uniformity of habits. I think that's true in one sense and not true in another. And I want to try and disaggregate that claim and to kind of put things into different boxes to try and elaborate more on what I thought their idea was. The melting pot idea, assimilation, meant assimilation into the understanding of the principles. The principles that I spoke of that Lincoln talked about that kind of united us all. But it didn't mean assimilation in our cultural patterns, our ethnic identities, or what have you. You could have both. You could have, Polish neighborhoods in Chicago and still a commitment to self-government. And it's the self-government that we expected assimilation from. And the immigration policies or ideas they had would be to welcome folks who were culturally capable of assimilating on those self-governing principles. That didn't mean they had to forego their different identities or cultural identities or ethnic heritages or what have you. And the reason I briefly mentioned, too little time to go into, Washington's letter to the Hebrew congregation is I think in that letter this idea is reflected. He's not asking them to give up their ways. The stock of Abraham, he says, you have as much liberty of conscience here as everybody. He didn't demand that they become Anglicans and assimilate in that direction. But the recognition of the liberty of conscience looked back to the principles that everybody had these universal human rights that existed a priori to government and was the reason we established as government. So I think you got to split the baby there. We can have both e pluribus and unum if we understand what it is we're unifying around. And I think kind of keeping that distinct, I think, is critically important to understanding the American idea.
Great. Marianne, do you have any?
I do. I'm going to push back against something Rick said. I agree with him that Hosanna Tabor is a case of revolutionary importance, introducing a corporatist model to the First Amendment religion clauses, really, for the first time. I have referred to it elsewhere as citizens of the City of God United. And its implications, I think, if taken seriously, and it's a Roberts opinion, he's a known for playing a long game. He wrote it before the rest of the court caught on to his long game. I think he's the sort of person who plants a seed and he sees the oak tree and nobody else does. One of the things that I find revolutionary about Hosanna Tabor is its alternate history of the Establishment Clause, starting with Magna Carta. And it's there that I want to push back against Rick. So Rick has long held this view that the freedom of the church is not concessionary. But I think if you start with Magna Carta and take Magna Carta seriously, and by the way, if anybody out there knows, if there's a Roberts clerk or something, I don't know where Roberts got this alternate history. It does not pre-exist in any of the briefs, in any of the cases, in any of the scholarship. He put together bits and pieces from a whole lot of things. How many briefs in Hosanna Tabor cited Magna Carta? One and in a footnote. But he starts a whole corporatist history of the Establishment Clause with Magna Carta. Magna Carta's operative language is Ecclesia Anglicane libera sit. Not libera est, but libera sit. It shall be free. That is a concession. That is not a recognition of a lack of authority. It's the privileges of the church. And what frightens me is that we are then returning to something that didn't work for Thomas Becket, right? I mean, within the lifetime of King John, the English church was no longer free, as Roberts concedes in his Hosanna Tabor opinion. But anyway, I commend Roberts' alternate history to your attention, substituting in effect, although not in fact, Jefferson to the Ursuline nuns for Jefferson to the Danbury Baptists, and then picking out selective corporatist examples all the way through.
Yeah, and any substitution of Jefferson's letter to the nuns for Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptists is welcome, in my view.
That's me, that's not Roberts.
So,
it's just his conception.
I don't agree that Hosanna Tabor is revolutionary, although I think it's really important, and I welcomed it. One reason why I think it wasn't revolutionary, or at least one bit of evidence for it not being so revolutionary, is the 9-0 vote. I don't think that comes about because of Robert's caginess. I think it comes about because of a sort of a unanimous shock of all the justices that the administration actually stood up in front of the court and argued that there was no such thing as a ministerial exception rooted in the First Amendment. The roots of Hosanna Tabor, I think, are very deeply planted in cases like Kedroff and the Serbian Archbishop case and Watson v. Jones and so on. But what I was going to say, actually, before Marianne's point, and we've, as you might guess, we've been having this conversation for a while, is I just want to underscore a point that Heather made, which I think is really intriguing, and I know for some conservatives is really kind of challenging, and that is that some of the constitutional cases establishing certain rights that localists and pluralists like are the result of, pretty
broad and freewheeling interpretations of federal constitutional provisions that are enacted, you know, in the wake of the Civil War, when half when the, you know, the rebellion is put down and treason is squashed, and using a provision that was, some would argue, kind of imposed on some states that they didn't really even want. I think you can say that about the Yoder case is a pretty broad interpretation of the Free Exercise Clause, even under the Sherbert regime. The Kedroff case, as Justice Jackson complained, was a kind of broad interpretation of the First Amendment, and you know, you can certainly say the thing about Meyer and Pierce. And as Heather says, that structure is certainly the structure on which some cases that a lot of conservatives are troubled by, like Roe and so on, rests. That's something that I think a lot of us have to wrestle with. I know I do. I'm not as ideologically opposed to the idea of, you know, federal judicial protection of unenumerated rights as some are, but if I were, then I might have to feel a little more uncomfortable than I do about cases like Yoder, which protects, in a sense, the internal integrity of a community, or Kedroff, which protects the internal decision-making structures of a church, or, for that matter, Pierce and Meyer, which protect the internal decision-making powers of families and religious schools. So it's an interesting point that she made. I think we all should reflect on it.
Thank you. Is it truly established that e pluribus unum, pluribus refused to peoples and not the states? I have read that it actually refers to states. So again, I would just, I certainly am educated, enlightened by John's point, but I think it's sort of too late in the discourse now to even want to rehabilitate multiculturalism as a concept and apply it back into the history. I think it's more dangerous to do so than not. And yes, there was obviously a strong and principled tolerance of cultural difference, but my point is simply that wasn't what this was all about. It really was about political concepts, civil society, and I think my guess is, and I'm purely speculating here, is there probably was an assumption that those differences would dissolve over time towards a more unified culture. But at this point, I just don't see the value in thinking about any of this in terms of multiculturalism, because the phrase is, from my perspective, far too toxic.
Great. I'll maybe just ask one constitutional question. I was many of the cases that you heard evoked here are unsurprising cases for this topic, but I was struck by Marianne's invocation of the Miller test. So that's quite an interesting thought. This is a constitutional right that seems to vary based on your community standards. And so is that anomalous? Should more constitutional rights work that way, or is Miller wrong? How do we think about that? Marianne or anybody else?
I think Miller is wrong. I think I understand why the Supreme Court wanted to get out of the business of watching dirty movies, and Miller was the best it could do to stop redrupping. But my first project was a descriptive one. Let's see what looks like this. And I found almost nothing did. I also do comparative law. In Europe, this is much more prevalent. There's this notion called the margin of appreciation, which suggests that there is the core of a right, and then if there isn't a consensus about the more outer boundaries of those rights, something can be a right in one country that can be prohibited in another, a book or a practice. I was looking to see if there was a margin of appreciation under US law. The closest thing I have found to that lately is the notion for which the Boudin opinion in the same-sex marriage cases is an interesting example, that there might be hydraulic pressure between the federal government and the state governments such that there might be a margin of appreciation for U.S. statutes in the sense that if the individual comes backed by his or her supporting state, whether that be for same-sex marriage, against the death penalty. There was simultaneously a case where the Rhode Island governor was saying, don't impose the federal death penalty on a Rhode Island-specific case. Medical marijuana, obscenity. We go back to Harlan's notion of obscenity that said, you know, there needs to be more play in the joints. The federal government should, you know, defer to states and not impose on states. So I think that kind of the Boudin notion is a place where Scalia's concept of hybrid rights, which, as the lower courts have said, made no sense at all in Smith, might make sense. The strongest hybridity then being between two very different kinds of claims, between an individual rights claim and a state's rights claim coming together.
Is this qualitatively different from the way that, say, due process property relies on state property law?
So that was where what I just described, yes, is. What I was originally looking for is strong examples of that. You know, most extreme state definitions of life. Can you be dead in one state and not in another?
Yeah.
I welcome suggestions as to what evidence there is for this, but I was not able to find a lot, and the strong examples included things like the one I mentioned, which is reasonableness. There's a lot of reasonable, you know, in our community we don't like, in our community we think the garbage is out there for everybody to take, whereas in this other community we're, but there's not a lot of examples of that are explicitly endorsed.
I've always thought Miller and its progeny kind of more a reflection of a recognition of the inadequacies of incorporation, particularly on things that's run so headlong into an exercise of the police power. We no longer define the police power in the way we used to. Health, safety, welfare, we tend to stop it there. But health, safety, welfare, and morals was the long-standing thing. And, of course, that runs headlong into a full incorporation of the First Amendment on speech, even on religion, but particularly on speech. There were a lot of things that the states could do in the exercise of their police power that we would not have tolerated a national government to do. And that was the line that held, and held well into the 20th century when incorporation, and they couldn't draw that line in an incorporation methodology that made any sense or that was coherent for them. And I think you end up with these oddities like Miller as a result of trying to confront that, not explicitly, but this kind of sub rosa problem with the whole doctrine.
Marianne reminded us of this idea we see in some of the European human rights law of a margin for appreciation. And that got me thinking about the Laozi case, you know, the crucifix case in Italy, where, if I remember right, tell me if I'm wrong, that part of the reasoning was that, look, in Italy you can do this, but maybe in some other places you couldn't. And some have suggested that there should be, or maybe there actually is, something kind of like that goes on in the application of the so-called endorsement test, where at least as the test got refined after Justice O'Connor originally promulgates it, it gets refined to sort of, and this is kind of stylized stuff, I realize, but to incorporate the sort of imagined reactions of the reasonable observer in the community familiar with the practices of that community. So there's an interesting Third Circuit case that Judge Alito decided involving holiday displays and all that, and Justice Alito says the display is fine in part because in that community, the reasonable observer knows that in that community, they recognize that all kinds of ethnic and religious holidays throughout the year. And so that was a reason why even the federal constitutional claim could be rejected. It could be rejected for, you know, New Jersey specific, I think the town was Jersey City, Jersey City specific reasons. And maybe it'd be interesting in American First Amendment law if we were more explicit about that. If these cases about symbols and displays and so on that, you know, sometimes seem just kind of weird, you know, to depend on the minutiae and interior decorating and all that kind of thing. If we were more explicit and said this is where we have kind of a margin of appreciation. I mean, some scholars have proposed as much, but I don't think the court's been as explicit as it could have been.
Other comments on this or anything else? No. So maybe we should open up to audience questions.
Yes, please. Yes, in the middle. Oh.
So just on the last point of discussion, Justice Stevens in the McDonald case wanted Second Amendment rights to vary by locality, but that's a dissent, of course. So. My question was, if you leave aside the First Amendment, are there provisions of the Constitution that could be understood as either endorsing multiculturalism or rejecting it? Or is this all just kind of left to politics? I was thinking of this when Heather McDonald was speaking about problems of immigration. I wonder, is the Constitution just silent on that? Is this just a political question, a political issue?
John, do you?
Oh, boy. Well, you know, it only comes after incorporation, but certainly the Eighth Amendment, what's unusual, something might be perfectly usual in one part of the country and radically unusual in another, that kind of lends itself to that kind of inquiry, but not ab initio, right? Not until we get incorporation, because it would have, you know, you would have a one size fits all at the federal government, and that would have been the limit of that amendment. So it's hard to look at these things, what the founders would have thought, when we only get there by way of an incorporation of something that happened 80 years later. What's that? Oh, the 10th Amendment. Yeah. Well, yeah, but you know, so I mean, you know, that in many ways that's just a truism. You know, the thing's not granted or reserved, but it leaves open what's reserved and to whom, to the states or to the people. Justice Kennedy in the term limits case just completely bollocks that issue. But it was reserved to the states or to the people because it was not a function of the federal constitution or the federal government to decide how the allocation of power at the local level was going to be determined. And that's why the 10th Amendment uses that language. And so that certainly invites not multiculturalism, but different answers to some of those questions on allocations of power between private and public sector at the state level.
So it seems to me that the provisions of the Constitution, again, putting aside the First Amendment and incorporation and all that, that might connect best with this multiculturalism conversation, or just the provisions that have to do with, you know, how you're going to populate the federal legislature, right? So, I mean, I think the founders are aware that even if there aren't radically different cultures in the various new states, that there are differences that are relevant among them in terms of, you know, economic interests and religion and other things. And so the Constitution is set up in such a way that, you know, near guarantees that the federal legislature is going to mirror, to some extent, the differences that existed across and among the states. You could have had a legislature, you know, you can imagine one, right, that's just kind of, you take the population and divide it by a certain number, and, you know, everybody votes on the representatives from everywhere, and you get the most number, and that, you know, we didn't do that, obviously, right? We allocated it in a different way that was going to collect whatever differences there were existing among the different political communities.
So this is just a throwaway line, but I find it interesting that the very first thing in the preamble is in order to form a more perfect union. Perfect is a very high standard for unions.
But something can be more perfect, yeah. It can be pretty imperfect.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, given what we just gone through, it was not a high bar to get over.
I suppose one could point to the religious tests clause. I suppose one could point to the swear or affirm language that John referenced, and I suppose one could point to the structure of federalism as well.
I would just again say I think the founders were really political animals. I don't think they were multiculturalists. I think they were extraordinarily sophisticated analysts of problems of political power and abuse for millennia. And they were structuring a document that they thought would best preserve political liberty, and that was the forefront of their thinking.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. Look, let's pose the challenge this way. They would have had, so 10, 15 years ago, there was a prostitution prosecution in Los Angeles. The prostitute raised it as a defense, a religious liberty defense. She claimed to be an heiress of an ancient Egyptian cult. that required sleeping with the heiress in order to pass into heaven. And it was a fee for the thing, just like Catholics passing in a collection basket. Happened to be $100, the going rate for prostitution in Los Angeles. Let's assume she was sincere in her religious belief. If we assume sincerity of that, we have a heck of a problem modernly rejecting her challenge. The founders would have had no problem whatsoever with that. And I think trying to figure out the difference between how they would have answered that challenge and how modernly we do, I think would be a very fruitful inquiry.
John McGinnis.
Yes, I guess my question is to perhaps particularly to Marianne Case, but I want to preface it with a bit of a comment. What's one other advantage?
John, can you speak into the mic, John?
Yes, one of the other advantages of multiculturalism might be the competition between cultures. I mean, it's not the case we actually know necessarily what the right set of rights are, right? They're not, they're in some sense always a tension between liberty and license. And the advantage of federalism, which is in some sense allows different cultures, is that actually we see a competition. People can exit from one state to another, and we see how cultures from Louisiana or New York work out. That seems to me an advantage of that structure, which may be threatened by the too easy an idea that we want to impose some set of rights. It might be the case that we want to do that when there's a consensus, but for instance, with respect to same-sex marriage, I think there's not that kind of consensus, certainly not an understanding of the Constitution. So I guess my question is, isn't an advantage of differences in culture an actual investigation of what kind of rights may help us flourish, and isn't shutting down that kind of competition a danger to one of the virtues of having a variety of cultures?
So I have to say I don't disagree. My project today is largely a descriptive one, and I will note again, coming back to Brandeis and Sutherland in New State Ice, there are two ways to interpret the Brandeisian notion of experiments. One is, and you interestingly seem to be focusing on that there is a right answer and that experimentation will allow us to see it. The other is the notion of permanent diversity. Right, there are different tastes and preferences, and diversity needs to be respected. I think what I was suggesting with respect to of a margin of appreciation for US statutes should be something that fits very nicely in with your scheme. That is to say, when an individual supported by a state is resisting a federal imposition of uniformity, it's largely in police power contexts where this works really nicely, whether that be the Defense of Marriage Act, and Ashcroft is at the center of all three of these, right? Ashcroft, a big proponent of the Defense of Marriage Act against experimentation then in the states, a big proponent of the federal death penalty, again, against experimentation in the states, including states who had abolished the death penalty for reasons of their local rights consciousness. Ashcroft also against physician-aided suicide, and in Gonzalez, what started out as Oregon v. Ashcroft ended up with Gonzalez v. Oregon, again, trying to impose from a federal legislative perspective an end to state experimentation in the direction of liberty. I think the Brady Bill case is a similar example, right? You have differences in tastes and preferences among the states. So this notion of a margin of appreciation for U.S. statutes is not a left-right thing, but is indeed exactly the sort of thing you suggest, which is states who are freedom-maximizing and behind their liberty-endorsing individuals should get some deference in the way that Harlan suggested should happen with federal obscenity laws.
Anyone else on that question? If you have a question, if you could please move to the microphone. Yep.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Good morning. My name is Diana Yuan. I am a second year law student.
Speak into the mic, please.
Right in.
I am a second year law student at Fordham University. And more importantly, I'm a Blackstone Fellow. So my question is primarily directed to Professor Garnett and Professor Eastman, because you both mentioned the One Nation Under God case. And in particular, Professor Eastman, you left us with the imagery of the opponent of the phrase One Nation Under God, yet the rationale is, well, of course, we have to appeal to the higher truth. My question is, within the existing United States legal order, is this a contradiction that, you know, eventually it contains the seeds of its own eventual demise, the idea of we will not acknowledge under God, yet my rationale is also a spiritual one? Is that a logic that will eventually destroy itself, or whether this idea will actually, this contradiction can actually sustain itself?
Yeah, so my point there, Michael Newdow was making the claim, even if the positive law of the First Amendment doesn't guarantee my right not to have to listen to the phrase under God when my daughter says the Pledge of Allegiance, I have a higher law, there's a higher law that pre-exists the governing law, the positive law of the First Amendment, and I have a natural law claim to that. And so what I was exploring with him in that conversation I had was, where does that come from? He said, well, you know, Declaration of Independence, I have unalienable rights. I said, well, read the clause before that. It says that we have these rights endowed by our Creator. The notion that we have rights that pre-exist government comes from that hierarchical structure, those inalienable truths that are in the Declaration. And without that, it was hard for him to make a claim that he could have some right that wasn't in the positive law. So I was trying to force him into that recognition. Now, I suppose you could say, well, there are other grounds for higher rights that pre-exist. You know, they're self-generated, they're Platonic forms, you know, but he didn't want to go anywhere. He was sticking with the inalienable rights in the Declaration, and it existed prior to government. And I kind of forced him into that. I think it was relevant here because it helps us distinguish between the things that we can have pluralistically and the things that we ought to be grappling with in a unified way. If there is some universal truth that is the foundation for the regime, then we assimilate around that truth. That doesn't mean we have to assimilate around all of the multiple variant things that are at the periphery. And I think it's trying to figure out where that dividing line is that modernly we have a great difficulty with. They did not at the time of the founding. Those I think were more self-evident to them.
Yes, sir.
Hi. I was just wondering, isn't the real threat of multiculturalism to the constitutional order is when we start giving out rights, recognition, both cultural and legal, to ethnic and racial groups, is when the majority discovers that it has its own ethnicity or religion, and that we get a sort of a majoritarian faction of the type that the Federalist Papers were particularly worried. Indeed, we're seeing this right now. I think the candidacies of certain presidential candidates are appealing to a white ethnic identity. We see it in New Jersey, where white parents are upset about the academic achievements of Asian students, and that what we will end up with, if we continue a legal recognition, cultural recognition of ethnic and religious groups, is the type of squabbling that, you know, Madison and Hamilton really were very fearful of. Not only squabbling, but tyranny, because the majority group will eventually develop an ethnic and religious identity that will demand political recognition.
I think that's a very good insight. And I remind people that, look, all of these notion of rights was never understood in terms of groups or ethnic cultures or whatever, but in individual terms. And that the move toward multiculturalism seems to me a rejection of the notion of individual rights in favor of group rights, which necessarily is going to lead to the kind of conflicts and factions that Madison and Hamilton were rightly concerned about and that you point out. And so, you know, one of the other reasons to push back against this modern multiculturalism as an ism rather than a description of we come from different cultures is precisely that.
I would agree with that, with the exception that I do not think, I disagree that the phrase has been bandied about by the website, the Federalist, that what we see now is a rise of white identity politics. I disagree with that. I think people are, I don't think that's what's going on. I think there's an assertion, an effort at asserting certain meritocratic principles, and your hypothetical is logically secure as a practical matter. I think that the demonization of traditional American culture, and which has been labeled by the multiculturalists as a manifestation of white privilege, so I'm going to use the ethnic racial category there, has been so complete that I do not see a possibility of the dominant, still demographically dominant culture rising up and saying, we are claiming an equality of virtue in the academic, you know, campus identity politics with other so-called oppressed groups. And I think what we've lived through, the nauseating capitulation of college president after college president over this last couple of months to the most preposterous, patently, demonstrably false claims of victimization on the part of minority students, to me is a sad adumbration of the future that we're moving in, which is an endless series of capitulation.
So I think there is another version of your story that is the religious version of the story, that the dominant religious groups, the evangelical Protestants and the Catholics, numerically quite dominant, are now moving to a strategy of accommodation that was designed for tiny minority religious groups, whether those be the Amish, the Jehovah's Witnesses, or the Native American peyote users. And this is why I worry about the new corporatism, the new feudalism, because those dominant groups, and I have a constitutional basis for this, because whatever you may say about American group versus individual rights in other contexts, there's an establishment clause problem if the dominant religious groups exercise their dominance over law in certain potentially problematic ways.
This is a minor point, but I mean, Marianne just used the phrase "moving to a strategy," and at least as I see it, the reason why we see some of these groups, like the Little Sisters or Notre Dame or who have you, invoking exemptions-type protections, which, as Marianne said, were designed more for the sort of smaller minority groups. The reason why that's happening is we have some anomalous, perhaps unprecedented exercises of government power that are. This is a new thing, right? Pushing back in pretty serious way against the moral and other views of what had been, you know, this cultural majority. I don't think it was so much of a sneaky move, let's move to start invoking accommodations, even though it wasn't designed for us. It's that we're in an environment where all of a sudden there's a need for accommodation, even of these groups that come out of traditions you might characterize as majority.
I wasn't remotely suggesting it was sneaky. I was simply suggesting that, as I think you suggest, it's a loser's strategy, right,
yes.
Accommodation.
Yes. Yes.
And it is, from establishment clause perspective, perhaps problematic how much the dominant religious groups were winners before then. I would think you, as a Catholic, looking at the history of the public schools, would not want to dispute that.
We have other audience questions?
Hi. Many of you have been speaking about toleration of differences, cultural differences. Heather, you went further than that. I wonder the extent to which the verb that accompanies multiculturalism today, which nobody has used yet, celebration, has changed the politics and the ideology of multiculturalism. We don't just have multiculturalism, or think it's a good idea, we celebrate it, and doesn't that complicate the world in which we live in?
So just one quick thought. It seems to me that whether or not that verb celebrate makes me uncomfortable anyway depends on which of these various senses of multiculturalism we're talking about, right? So I can imagine with respect to some differences having the attitude not so much of celebration but the world's complicated and you know this side of heaven there's going to be disagreements and it doesn't make sense to try to make straight every crooked timber and so you deal with it. But I think there are other kinds of multiculturalism, like I think the sort of plural powers idea that I actually am kind of happy to celebrate. I think it's a good thing for the human condition for there to be lots of different locations, spaces, and sites where people can kind of be formed and be taught and be governed. And it seems to me that's actually a good thing. So I can celebrate that, celebrate political pluralism. And I'm also perfectly happy to celebrate the sort of food court sense of diversity because it makes life a lot more interesting. But where I admit to being uncomfortable with the sort of the celebrate diversity and we mean it, you must do it, is when we're talking about those senses of multiculturalism that are more like identity politics. I'm not sure why I want to celebrate identity politics.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. If the multiculturalism we're talking about is a diversity of opinion about central propositions that are necessary at the foundation of the regime, then not only are we not to be celebrating it, we ought to be doing everything we can to discourage it. And the reference to Jim Crow as a multiculturalism thing I thought was particularly appropriate. The notion that self-evident truth of equality in the Declaration can have radically opposite meanings, that the protection of property in somebody else's labor, which is a full deprivation of liberty, can be equally celebrated and are equally valued cultural norms, is preposterous from the perspective of the founders. And so if that's the kind of diversity we want to celebrate, then absolutely not. And again, this goes back to what are the things that we gravitate toward in unification that makes the American idea unique, and what are all those things that are collateral to that makes us interesting, what Rick has called the food court diversity or multiculturalism, but it's wonderful. You walk down here down to 42nd Street and you run into 100 different kind of restaurants. That's terrific because none of them undermine the core central principle. It's when you get to things that start undermining that core central principle and people want to celebrate that kind of multicultural diversity that we have a real problem.
I would just offer us a hesitantly dissenting view on this celebration of diversity. It may be all well and good as a ideal and something we should pay lip service to that idea, but I think, again, social science does not necessarily bear that out. Robert Putnam, a sociologist at Harvard, who's no conservative, studied communities that were very diverse, and what he found was, across the board, a strong decrease in trust, cooperation, social capital. So the reality sometimes is different than the ideological celebration of food court diversity. That's not to say that this is not the reality of America and something that we rightly live with, but I think that it's a little bit of a whitewash to say that that sort of radical diversity is necessarily a boon always to communities. And this is simply as an empirical matter.
But can I ask about the Putnam study? Because it's been a little while since I read it, and I was sort of, one is kind of struck by his conclusion. It seemed to me that he was saying that the communities he was studying where you saw this breakdown in trust were diverse or multicultural, not just in the what I've been calling the food court sense, that these were communities that were balkanized and multicultural and diverse in these ways that might be themselves more problematic, that they really were communities where there was deeper divisions on some of these things that John might call first principles, and not just the kind of the plethora of restaurants going down 7th Avenue, or am I misremembering the paper?
Well, I think he was mostly looking at racial and ethnic diversity, but we'd have to look at that again.
Our own Leotis, who organized this conference.
What are the things that we have to have unity about, and what are the things that it's okay to have diversity about?
Yeah, so, I always like to go back to the Declaration. I think it's a tremendous statement. We have to have unity about the idea that there are inalienable rights, that there are some things that even majorities can't take away. We have to have unity about the idea that the purpose of government is to secure those rights, not to transfer property from one group to another. That seems to be the real seed of discord that flows out of the modern multicultural movement, which is as Rick, I think, adequately described, an identity politics aiming at claiming political power and property and even liberty from other groups. This notion of group mentality is a rejection of that fundamental principle. And until we get back to a unity on that fundamental principle, this whole multiculturalism of modern advent is going to rip us apart. And I think that more than anything is why we're seeing things spin out of control.
But I think we cannot ignore the fact that one dominant group did control a whole lot of things, and what other groups are demanding is their place in that sun. I mean, I come back to, again, the public schools and marriage as classic examples of the way in which Protestantism dominated the law. I have done a study of what public officials' marriage ceremonies look like. Every one of them has got in their desk drawer, and many states have in their statutes, a form of the marriage ceremony that is a direct descendant of the Book of Common Prayer. You can all recite it. You've seen it in movies. Dearly beloved, we are gathered here together. I have yet to find a public official with a ketubah in his or her desk drawer. That, for the Jews to say the public marriage, laws of marriage are not ours, or the Muslims, or the same-sex couples, is not for them to be identitarian, but it is for them to recognize the identitarianism of the dominant group and call for their own space as well.
John, I wonder, following up on Lee's point, so, an argument that I hear a lot and has a lot of purchase in today's political debates is that among the things that we have to have agreement and uniformity and consistent practice on is anti-discrimination. And not only anti-discrimination by government, but anti-discrimination in the middle space, in civil society, in places of public accommodation, in the public square. And so, Robin West has made this argument very powerfully, I think, that folks like me who like Hosanna Tabor are actually kind of like the people you're describing who aren't buying into the foundational truths of the Declaration. I'm hoping she's wrong about that, but what would you say?
Well, look, there was a time in our not-so-distant past where the word discriminating was a virtue rather than a vice. And we've lost that sense of what it means to be discriminating and who we choose as our friends. We want our kids to be discriminating in who they choose as their friends in school so they don't have bad influences. And that word has now lost all sense of that aspect of the meaning. You can't answer the question on whether we should be uniform around an idea of anti-discrimination without asking anti-discrimination with respect to what? All right, and it's our failure to ask that second half of the question in the multicultural world we live in now that has made it impossible to even have a discourse about that kind of thing, and I think getting back to that understanding again requires us a recourse to the first principles, and I want to take up something Mary Ann's. Look. Let's take as a given that there was unequal and unjust distribution of property because of inherited wealth. There are two ways to address that problem. One of them is the way Hawaii did it in Hawaii versus Midkiff, which is to confiscate people's property and redistribute it, which undermines that core central idea in the Declaration, or one of the core central ideas. The other way was Jefferson's way, which is to abolish the laws of primogeniture and entail that allowed that thing to evenly distribute out over time without undermining the natural right that was at the basis of property in the first place. And I think thinking through those two answers to that problem can be applied in all of the different contexts that you just raised a minute ago, and see if there's a ways that can be deal with those old inherited problems in a way that doesn't undermine the natural law, natural rights claims that supersede government, and other ways that would undermine those and make it more difficult to have that unifying core. And asking the question in those terms, I think, will help us advance the ball a little bit.
I mean, I don't see a way to do what you suggest that doesn't give us same-sex marriage, for example. But let me say something different, which is one other thing that has not been mentioned, because we've been focusing on rights and constitutionalism, is another thing I think the Federalist Society is into, which is free trade. And I am more and more drawn to Montesquieu's notion of du commerce. And one of the things that worries me that you can describe as multiculturalism is that business relations have become far more personalized in recent years. So I will not do business with you if you have certain views apart from our business transaction that I disapprove of, whether there's entry into a same-sex marriage or opposition to same-sex marriage. So there's a new line item in business transactions, which is the emotional or dignitary consequence, which I think is very dangerous for our life together as Americans. Not unconstitutional, but not a trend I'm happy to see.
Purely personal matter, rather than something that is a deeply thought out principle about this complicated area of pluralism, my desideratum of the unifying principle would be knowledge. And one can say that a nation is the store of memories that are preserved. I would like to see unity on a gratitude for the glories of civilization, Western civilization and world civilization, that has been passed down to us, and a core dissemination of some of the extraordinary accomplishments of thought and creativity that I think all citizens should be in possession of.
Obviously, this group could go on for hours, but I'm told that we are out of time. Please join me in thanking our panelists. And Eugene, if you're awake and at home watching, we thank you as well. Leotis is going to tell you what happens now.
Indeed. This is actually, we're now going to dissolve into pluribus. That is to say that at 11 o'clock we have our final event, which is our final session of 7-minute presentations. And there are two panels of those. They are going to take place upstairs on the third floor. Just take the elevator up one floor, and they will be in Liberty 1 and 2, I think, or is 4 and 5, excuse me, Liberty 4 and 5. And there will not be coffee there, so if you want more coffee, grab it now. I just want to also, before we dissolve, thank all of my colleagues who have done a fantastic job helping keep everything running. Anthony Deardorff, the Deputy Faculty Division Director, Christopher Goffus, the Assistant Faculty Division Director, and Diane, there we are, and also Daniel Richards, who has been helping us technologically, as well as Matt, who has also been doing our video and so on. So thanks everybody, and thanks again to the panel for a terrific discussion this morning.
And thank you, Leotis.